brought to you by Penguin.
Armadillo by William Boyd, read by John Sackville. Chapter 1. In these times of ours, and we don't need to be precise about the exact date, but anyway, very early in the year, a young man, not much over 30, tall, 6 feet plus an inch or two, with ink-dark hair and a serious-looking, fine-featured but pallid face, went to keep a business appointment and discovered a hanged man. Lorimer Black stared aghast at Mr. Dupree, his mind at once clamorous with shocked alarm and curiously inert. The warring symptoms of a form of mental panic, he supposed. Mr. Dupree had hanged himself from a thinly lagged water pipe that crossed the ceiling in the little anteroom behind reception. A small set of aluminium folding steps lay on its side beneath his slightly splayed feet. His tan shoes needed a good clean, Lorimer noticed. Mr. Dupree was simultaneously the first dead person he had encountered in his life, his first suicide, and his first hanged man, and Lorimer found this congruence of firsts deeply troubling. His eyes travelled reluctantly upwards from Mr. Dupree's scuffed toe caps, pausing briefly at the groin area, where he could discern no sign of the fabled impromptu erection of the hangee, and moved on up to his face. Mr. Dupree's head was hunched too far over, and his expression was slumped and sleepy, like that worn by exhausted commuters who doze off in overheated railway carriages, propped upright by badly designed banquettes. If you had seen Mr. Dupree snoozing opposite you on the 1812 from Liverpool Street, his head canted over in that awkward position, you would have ached presciently for the stiff neck he was bound to experience on awakening. Stiff neck. Crick neck. Broken neck. Christ. Lorimer carefully placed his briefcase on the floor, stepped past Mr. Dupree, and moved quietly to the door at the end of the anteroom. He opened it and peered out over the devastated expanse of the factory. Through the blackened and carbonized joists and beams of the roof, he could see the low, unrelieved pewter of the sky. The floor was still covered with the charred and melted naked bodies of a near 1,000 plastic mannequins, 976, according to the documentation, a consignment destined for a chain of stores in the USA. All that mangled and ruined flesh provoked a shiver of ersatz disgust and horror. Ersatz, because they weren't real. After all, he told himself, no pain had been suffered. But here and there was preserved a head of cartoon handsomeness, or a tanned girl smiling a smile of preposterous welcome. The unchanging good nature of their expressions lent a certain touching stoicism to the scene. And beyond, Lorimer knew from the report, lay the torched workshops, the design studios, the clay and plaster sculpture rooms, the moulding lines. The fire had been unusually fierce and typically thorough. Apparently, Mr. Dupree had been insistent that nothing would be touched, not a melted model budged, until he received his money, and, Lorimer could see, Mr. Dupree's word had been steadfast. Lorimer exhaled and made little popping noises with his lips. "Hmm," he said out loud, then, "Jesus H. Christ," then, "Hmm," again. He realized his hands were shaking slightly, so he thrust them in his pockets. The phrase, "a bad business," began to repeat itself moronically, mantrically in his head. He speculated vaguely and reluctantly about Hogg's reaction to the Dupree suicide. Hogg had told him about toppers before, and Lorimer wondered what the procedure was. He closed the door, worried for a second about fingerprints, and then thought, why would they dust for a suicide? It wasn't until he was back in reception and reaching for the phone that another thought entered his mind that possibly, just possibly, it might not have been suicide after all. The detective who came as the result of his call to the police, Detective Sergeant Rappaport, seemed not much older than Lorimer, but called him Sir regularly, and a little needlessly all the same. Dennis P. Rappaport, it had said on his ID.
You say you had an appointment with Mr. Dupree, sir?
Yes. It had been booked for over a week. Lorimer handed over his business card. I was here promptly at 10:30. They were standing outside now, beneath the cursive red plastic sign that read, Osmond Dupree, Display Mannequins, established 1957. Police and other officials busied themselves with Mr. Dupree's mortal remains inside. A constable diligently wound fluttering striped tape around lampposts and railings, notionally sealing off the front of the factory and banning access to half a dozen cold, expressionless bystanders curiously looking on. Waiting for the body bag, Lorimer thought. Charming. Detective Sergeant Rappaport carefully studied the business card and then performed a histrionic pouching mime. May I, sir? By all means. From his leather jacket, Rappaport produced a fat wallet and slipped Lorimer's card inside.
Not your average beginning to your average sort of day, sir, I would imagine?
No. Most distressing. Lorimer agreed, watchfully. Rappaport was a burly fellow, beefy and blonde with cornflower blue eyes, the sort of looks unsuitable in a detective, Lorimer thought, for some reason, thinking instead that Rappaport should have been a surfer or a tennis pro or a waiter in a Los Angeles restaurant. Furthermore, Lorimer wasn't sure if Rappaport's deference was meant to unnerve, reassure, or to be subversively ironic in some way. On balance, he thought it was probably the last. Rappaport would have a chortle about its effect later in the mess or canteen or the pub, or wherever it was the detectives gathered to natter and moan about their respective days.
Now we know where to find you, sir. We won't trouble you any further. Thank you for your assistance, sir.
More than ironic, the blatant overuse of sir, Lorimer thought, was clearly and deliberately patronizing. There was no doubt about that. But at the same time, a conversational irritant, a covert sneer, impossible to protest against.
Can we run you back anywhere, sir?
No, thank you, Detective Rappaport. My car's round the corner. The T is silent, sir. Rappaport, old Norman name. Old Norman smug bastard, Lorimer thought, as he walked back to his Toyota in Bolton Place. But you wouldn't be quite so pleased with yourself if you knew what I had in my briefcase, he reflected, cheering himself up somewhat as he turned into the square. The improved mood was transitory, however. As he unlocked his car door, he felt a depression settle on him like a shawl, almost physically there, across his back and shoulders, as he considered Mr. Dupree's desperate, humble demise. What drove a man to tie a washing line to a water pipe, slip a noose around his neck, and kick away the aluminium steps that supported him? It was the memory of his scuffed shoes hanging 3 feet off the ground that stayed with Lorimer, rather than the grotesque loll of the head. That, and the miserable January day, bleak and dull, and Bolton Place. Its naked plane trees with their Gulf War camouflage, the struggling, tarnished light, the cold, a wind had freshened, and the morning's rain had left the sooty brick of the entirely acceptable Georgian houses almost charcoal-coloured. A child in a padded moss-green jacket tottered here and there on the central rectangle of lawn, vainly seeking distraction. First among the sodden cropped flowerbeds, then with a wily thrush, then scuffing up a few remaining dead leaves and flinging them aimlessly about. In a corner on a bench, its nanny or childminder or mother watched, smoking a cigarette and swigging something from a lurid can. City Square, venerable buildings, a patch of tended green, an innocently happy toddler, a concerned supervising adult. In any other context, these ingredients might have conspired to form a more joyous symbolism. But not today, Lorimer thought. Not today. He was pulling out of the square onto the main road when a taxi passed a little too close to the front of his car, and he was forced to lurch abruptly to a stop. The wobbly diorama of Bolton Place slid along the taxi's glossy black side, and his oath caught in his throat as he saw the face framed in the rear window. This happened to him from time to time, occasionally several times in 1 week. He would see a face in a crowd, through a shop window, going down the escalator of the underground as he went up, that was of such luminous, transfiguring beauty that it made him both want to shout in exultant surprise and weep with frustration.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.